And let's face it, Sister Dietrich, did not the religious leaders of the day, were they not very...
stoic?
What's the word I want to use, like where you're not confident? You're intimidated. Intimidated by anybody who would want to usurp their authority. So I'm sure news traveled, had they not been there, I'm sure news traveled, especially when the dove descends and God speaks. Let me tell you what, I'd be telling folks about that.
Yeah, me too. Me too.
You know, the woman at the well, she said, come meet a man who told me everything that I ever done.
Yeah.
You know, she was amazed. You know, news travels fast. And so, as he said, he went on down to verse number, well, let me just read verse number 4. And when he puts forth his, well, let me jump back to verse number 3. Actually, verse number 2. But he who enters in by the door, or the way, is the shepherd of the sheep. Once again, Jesus Christ alone is the true shepherd. To him the porter, this is the doorkeeper or the law. The law is the doorkeeper, right? And the only way that anyone could be admitted through that door would he'd have to be the keeper of the law. Because the law really is the doorkeeper. And the only one who kept the law, the one and only one who fulfilled it in every which way, was the very Son of God.
Yes.
No one before, no one after. And the sheep hear his voice. Praise God that the voice of the shepherd awakens a dead soul. Praise God. Did you hear what I said tonight? The voice of the shepherd awakens a dead soul. And he calls his own sheep by name. Amen. The relationship of salvation brings automatically this intimate relationship between God and man. Praise God. The voice of the shepherd. You know, I noticed my wife's voice. Her voice is distinctive above all other voices to me. I hear it, I don't have to say, who is this? And our voice. You ever get a phone call from someone, they call you and begin to talk away, and you're like trying to put the pieces of the puzzle together. This is before caller ID, okay? All you smart people out there. And you're trying to put all the pictures, pieces of the puzzle together, and you just simply say, I'm sorry, I don't recognize your voice, or I don't recognize your face. Well, the intimacy with God, we recognize. And he speaks. The Bible says, he leads them out in suitable pastures. Amen. He leads them into all truth. How many wants to be led into truth? In a world of so much inconsistency. It's truth. And when he puts forth his own sheep, he's the owner of the sheep. He has a love for us. He goes before them. Let me just say this tonight. Listen. Everything, as we follow this plan, everything and every place that we go to has been pre-planned by the Savior. Wow. God, you planned for me to be here. You planned for me to be here. I'm listening to your voice. You're leading me. It's your plan for me to be here. And the sheep follows him, for they know his voice. The true heart, for the true Son of God, will know the true voice of God. And a stranger will they not follow, but they will flee. You know, the thieves, the false prophets, the real sheep flees them. for they know not the voice of the stranger. This parable spoke Jesus unto them, but they understood not the things they were which he spoke unto them. You know why the Pharisees didn't understand? Because they weren't your sheep. They were led by the law, the Torah, the Pentateuch, whatever you want. They were led by that. But they really weren't true sheep. Did you ever meet someone who has a real head knowledge of God? But they've never had a regeneration of the Spirit of God in their soul. So it's hard for them to understand. You know, my wife and I, when we were going through everything we were going through a few years ago and seeking God for our family, I'm not going to get into a lot of details, but we had to seek out, medical attention. And when we went to our doctor and we talked to our doctor, their advisement for us contradicted the Word of God. It contradicted the basis of what we thought would honor God. So we said we can't do that. What's amazing, insurance companies do not listen to religious rights of people. No. So the insurance company said, well, we won't pay. That's okay, it doesn't matter. If we have to pay out of pocket, that's fine, we'll pay out of pocket. Well, we're not going to compromise our religious conviction. And our doctor said, wow, 20 years, I've only had 5 people ever do this. Wow. You know what? We knew that God had already spoke to us. And though they may have thought that was off the wall and crazy, that's okay. They don't understand because their minds have not been touched by the gospel of Jesus Christ. And they have not experienced the shepherd. And so they're led by a lot of voices. But God help us to be led by the voice of God. And I'm glad we were. Hey, let me tell you something. Sometimes, this is by my experience, sometimes it's tough getting led by the voice of God. You're kind of the person that's looked at like you're further on the ball. Or like you're crazy. But it's okay, the world doesn't understand. But as long as we know that we've entered in the sheepfold and we're listening to the shepherd's voice, that is what matters. I've got to wrap things up. I didn't even get halfway through what I wanted to get through. Then Jesus said unto them again, verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. The I am. He is the exclusive door. I was talking to, depending on who you are or your gender or your religious tradition, if you visit some homes, there's some doors you can't enter through. You know, Sister Rachel, you being a woman, if you were in some religious traditions, I'll say it that way, you could enter in through the front door. Because you're a woman. Sister Dietrich, you wouldn't either. Sorry. Even if it's a longer journey, you have to go to the side door. But Eli, but the good news is, there is exclusively one door. He said, I am the door.
Yes.
All of us have got to get under him. Because he is the door to salvation. He is the door to heaven. I want to be careful because I don't want to be accused of being slamming on religions. But some religious organizations believe the church is the door. You pay your penance to the church. You pay your loyalty to the church, and that is your entrance in. The church is not the entrance into heaven. Jesus Christ is. And so the Bible says that Jesus said, if any man enter, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pastures. There is safety and there's protection and there's pleasant places in Christ. But he says, the thief cometh not. This is the ones preaching another gospel. This is the one saying there's another way. The thief cometh not, but to steal and to kill, the Bible says, and destroy. Amen. Any other way, anyone peddling any other way or any other religion is a thief, a robber, a murderer. I am come that they might have a life, and they might have it more abundantly. Listen, the source of life is in Christ. And believers have it, and they have it more abundantly. That is the greatest joy of that man. The greatest joy.
Amen.
The greatest joy. Sister Dietrich, you said as well that when you heard about Heather, that you had peace. I would say that your same peace, we could put an equal sign to and equate it with joy. Because your confidence was in God, and God had deeply instilled that in you. That is the source of what a believer has, is peace and joy. Because we have entered in through Him. We come in and out through Him. Every aspect of our life, in our day-to-day living, is through Christ. In and through Him. I'm going to stop there. I'm sorry I didn't get farther. But I just felt like I wanted to bring a little bit of clarity, if nothing else tonight, to the fact that Christ was talking to those religious leaders. And, you know, they thought they had it all down with the Torah. But He was saying to them, no, I'm giving you the truth. There is one way, and salvation through grace. Sometimes it makes me nervous to leave things there. I'm saying tonight, because sometimes grace thinks it's like this namby-pamby, tiptoe around the tulips gospel that we never preach against sin. The grace of God delivers from sin, not excuses sin. And so, I'm thankful for the grace of God, for the door that we enter into. Someone have anything they'd like to add or say tonight?
Well, you know, when you said about the sheep, you know, going into the gate, I always was wondering, you know, about Saul, you know, when he was in that cave and sits on the bench. And then when you said that, it hit me that theologically awful thing for the sheep.
Yes.
You see, you sit on a man in a cave like that. So it would have to be, like you said, the place that they the sheep, because they could have something like 1,000 or maybe even more.
Yes.
So you know that cave had an act to be awful thing.
And I would like to stand here and act like a scholar and tell you that I knew all that. I never read that in my study. But it's interesting, because for me, oftentimes, it's a reading over without really thinking about. That was huge, that cave.
But I didn't really know that we used that for a sheep. I think you brought out and I thought, yeah, that's why.
And it would, you know, the way that it would work, because the sheep being there and the waste products and them walking on it created that that almost like a hard cement, almost like at least hard dirt, which made it, you know, and we're not talking about going into a barn where some sheep had just been there last night and now we're laying down in this. We're talking about over a period of time, what's happening there. Yeah, it's huge. And we think we have caravans. Yeah, it'd be interesting to see what.
Do they feel like that you're getting it or not?
I don't know. I would say yes. I mean, but I don't know. But yeah, and it wasn't just one man's sheep. It was a multitude of shepherd's sheep.
And that was my
yeah. Yeah, so it is the Word of God. Boy, the more you study it, don't you feel like I've gained a lot of knowledge, but there's so much I don't yet know. That's so deep. So deep. But that, you know, this really spoke to me. I hope the things in John, for me, just the realization, it almost seems like even as I'm studying for other messages, I'm being more aware than what I've ever been, that John, his gospel, is so diversely different than the first three gospels in his presentation. And, you know, we talked about love being mentioned the first time in the Gospels, but John referring to himself as the beloved disciple. Just he had the knowledge of love, of course, with Abraham and Isaac, and the love that God had toward his son. And then he realized as a son that he was loved. We are loved as sons and daughters. Praise God. Anything else tonight? If not, let's stand. Thank you for being here. Like I said, I know a few folks had some things going on this evening. We missed them. Be back next week. Jump in. And as we're shifting to, we're looking at John. If there's something else you want to study on Tuesday night, present it to me. I'll do my best to study it. I want to be led by the Spirit of God, but I want to be that we are teaching and dealing with things that that are resources that we need. So if there's something you want to look at, let me know.
Okay.
Yes, I forgot last Sunday. Yes, spring up this Saturday night. Spring up. All right?
Yeah.
I like the fall. I don't like the spring up. Me too. Would you talk to President Trump for me?
I would like to.
He might voice his opinion too. Look out Twitter. Here it comes. Yes, I thank you, Brother Eli. I knew on Sunday evening, Brother David and I was talking. He said to me, we forgot to put daylight savings time in. So don't forget to spring up. The good news is this. We're going to have a more daylight evening.
Yes.
How about that? Perspective. Praise God. Sister Rachel, will you close us in prayer?